I'm old enough to remember that song, Only You.
Yep.
Can make my dreams come true. Yeah, and I do remember the marching commercial too, but not as well. Well, believe me, I was raised by my grandfather. I know a lot of old songs. Way back. Yeah. I want to honor my wife, Beth. She's an amazing lady, and she's made me a lot of who I am today just by loving me and putting up with me and giving me time to grow up. She's an artist, too, by the way, and I showed her that picture over there of Jesus, and I said, Beth, you could do that. So she's praying about it, so pray for her, because I think that would be great if every church in town had something like that, right? Yeah. Well, I mean, you got some great art here. Or that's amazing, too. Wow. I mean, it's all great. Just a beautiful place. Well, today, the Lord's given me a message that is really a follow-on to Pastor Nikki's message at the service this past week for Ginger. And I've never preached a message quite like this. And so it's a little radical, but I'm told you like radical.
Yes.
Jesus was pretty radical. I think God's pretty radical. Come on, send his own son to die for other people who were rebels against him. That's pretty radical.
Yeah.
So let's pray. Father God, I pray that the words of my mouth and what people hear and what people do with what they hear, both from you, your Holy Spirit, and from me, Lord, would be pleasing and would build the kingdom, would bring heaven to earth in our lifetime and beyond. We pray, God, that you will make this time a time of communion of our hearts with yours and of our minds with yours. I pray for a communion of truth, that the truth of the scriptures and the truth that's in heaven would seep and percolate into us in a new and fresh way today, God. Thank you, God, that you're here. In Jesus' name, amen. So the title of the message, oh, it's already up there. I've already shocked you, right? The blessedness of death. Oh, my gosh. When I wrote that, I thought, oh, I hope they can handle this. So it's called a divine oxymoron. Does that word throw you, oxymoron? It's an apparent contradiction. That's what it means, oxymoron, apparent contradiction. So it isn't really a contradiction, but it looks like a contradiction. The blessedness of death. Reminds me of that movie, What About Bob? Yeah. We saw the house that it was filmed in. It's over at the Smith Mountain Lake. We drove down to the cul-de-sac, and there was the house. And then we drove across the lake, and there was the gas station where he gets off the bus with the goldfish around his neck. The gas station's there. They have pictures of the filming inside this old, decrepit, abandoned gas station, and the pictures are sitting there. It's like a tourist gold mine, and nobody was doing anything with it. Couldn't believe it. But at the end of What About Bob, he talked about, you know, writing a book on death therapy. So it reminds kind of the blessedness of death. Some of these parts of this message, actually, the Lord revealed to me when I was about 11. I was grieving the death of my parents' marriage, actually. And I was growing up without them, neither one of them, growing up with grandparents who were pretty dysfunctional. They tried to be, you know, as good as they could, but they really didn't know how to love kids. And so I'm looking out over Delaware Bay, and the Lord just gave me the ability to know that, you know, life is temporary and life is fragile, but I'm going to heaven. Now, that meant a lot to me when I was 11, and everything was crashing around me, but I knew that life was meant to be temporary, and life was fragile, and I was going to heaven. And I think that's a wise and wonderful and powerful set of truths for every person on earth who knows the Lord to hang on to. Life on earth is not meant to be heaven. We pray that heaven will come down to earth, but obviously, if you've read anything about history or current events, earth is not heaven. And the Bible says it gets worse towards the end. So I picked the scripture, well, the Lord picked the scripture. As soon as I sat down to write out my notes, this scripture popped into my mind. Psalm 116, verse 15. Blessed or precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. That is the divine oxymoron. Blessed in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. That should be an oxymoron to most of us. In 1997, I was escorting a lady and her two young daughters around Kempsville from CBN and then over to Rock Church where she was going to speak. And her name was Ruth Rubal, R-U-I-B-A-L. Ruth was, I first heard of her on a George Otis transformation video about the city of Cali, Colombia, where in 1995, her husband, Julio, was working hard to unify the churches so that the churches, the pastors, and the churches could pray together and work together to rescue a city that was in the iron grip of vicious drug cartels who were running the city in every department with money and guns. There was a dozen murders a day in Cali back then, mostly drug-related. You probably remember those times in the mid to late 80s when drug cartels down there were just basically running the country. Well, Julio was not really able to make much progress getting these pastors together. He was one of the leaders of this group of pastors trying to get unity among all these evangelical pastors, about 200 of them in the city. But you may know, as many people do, that getting pastors together is like herding cats. They have great difficulty trusting one another, feeling safe with one another. They have all their competitiveness comes to the surface, and their sense of jealousy and pride and ego. It's the greatest stronghold in the church around the world, I believe. I say that after much consideration and observation. I've talked to pastors in India. It's worse over there because they have small churches, and if you collaborate with another pastor and one of your families leaves and goes to the other church, you've lost a significant portion of your income. So it's a lot about nickels and noses why they don't want to get together, but it's really born out of the other 3:16, 2 Timothy 3:16, which says, where there's selfish ambition and jealousy, there's every form of evil. And that's born out of insecurity. It's not, they're good people, but they're insecure, and that insecurity brings their selfish ambition and jealousy to the surface. And it's a great stronghold. Anyhow, it was not happening in Cali, like it really doesn't happen anywhere in the world practically. And then one day in 1995, Julio was assassinated by a neighbor right in front of his house over a property dispute. And in the video, as Ruth, this lady I was escorting, comes to the scene where her husband lies crumpled in a pool of blood on the sidewalk, the first thing that pops into her mind was that verse, "Blessed in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." So that's where I first heard that verse that really impacted me. And here I was meeting the widow. Well, nobody could have imagined the blessings that came from Julio's death. The pastors were so shocked by this assassination that they finally laid aside their differences, their ambitions, their jealousies, and they decided to pray and work together for the sake of the city. And out of that came a great citywide revival that the transformation video documents in some detail, and it's beautiful. And that video and the story of the revival in Cali has gone around the world many times. Very dramatic blessings from the death of this wonderful pastor. So, but most of us, when we die, we're probably not going to cause that reaction in the community. So why would God call the death of his saints a blessed event? Blessed in the sight of the Lord. It seems like a contradiction that a loving God would see his children dying and say, that is a blessed event. I'd like to build my message on what Pastor Nikki preached this past week at the celebration service for Ginger, but go into a little more detail and maybe with a little bit different perspective, but it's basically the same thing. I want us to look at death from the viewpoint of God, from the viewpoint of heaven, which of course is not something we think of naturally because we haven't been to heaven yet, but there are hints in the Bible as to how God views the death of his children. But let me start off by telling you about a death that's very close to me that happened last year, the death of my father. He lived with us, with Beth and I, for 5.5 years, and he was one of the most wonderful men you could ever meet. I mean, literally, everybody fell in love with my dad when they met him. He was about 90 at the time. People in the grocery stores, people in the doctor's offices, His personal doctor came to the house twice to check up on my dad. That's a miracle in itself.
Yes.
Because he just fell in love with my dad, as everybody did. So I found my dad at 5 p.m. on September 28th, 2019, lying on the floor of the kitchen in his apartment, which was attached to our house. And I thought he'd passed out. But then as the realizations hit me that no, my dad was dead, for the first time in my life, I actually got dizzy just from emotions. I've seen it in movies, but it never had happened to me. Where I actually felt dizzy for a moment there. And then a few minutes later, God spoke to me so graciously. And he said a few things then, and then a few things tomorrow, or the next day, which I'd like to show you in this video that Beth and I recorded within 24 hours of the death. And we did it because we knew we didn't have the strength to tell everybody the story so soon after his death. So we put it on YouTube. And so people could kind of listen on YouTube. So if you'll play that now, Jason, that would be great. It's just about 2 minutes.
In closing, some of the things the Lord told me that have helped me get to a better place at this point. I'm just a little over 24 hours since Dad went home to heaven. So right after he died, I was alone in the room. I felt like the Lord immediately said, he's with me, he's safe, he's gloriously happy, and which I wonder, well, maybe that's just me thinking. But then the next phrase, I knew it wasn't me thinking, and he said, and you don't have to worry about him anymore. Well,
yeah.
That's not something I would have said to myself.
Yeah.
I wasn't really even conscious of that a lot of times, but when he said, I said, oh yeah, you're right. I did worry about him a lot. Yeah, it would really disturb me when Dad wasn't feeling well. So, and then today, this afternoon, the Lord was impressing upon me thoughts like, you know, well, why are you still hanging on? You know, why don't you let him go? He needs to be here. He is here. And he's tremendously happy. He's with family. He's with your brother, Jim, who's ecstatic about it. He's with his parents, he's with both of his wives, and there's a reconciliation all the way around. So, you know, why don't you let him go? I said, yeah, God, you're right. Why don't I let him go? Why is it so hard? I've always wanted him to be happy and safe, and he's happier and safer there in heaven than he ever could be here.
Yeah.
And I did want to hold his hand as he died in bed and that sort of thing, but he would have been bedridden probably for the next month. He was close to being bedridden. He was close to being to suffering at a much higher degree.
He had to do so much over not
yeah.
his breath.
He probably would have been highly medicated with morphine or something like that. And it would have been bedpans, the whole deal. It would have been a mess. And it would have been hard on him and us. And so, God, I prayed, you know, we've been praying for a while, Lord, take him home with dignity. And painless as possible, and the Lord did.
If I ever do another one of those videos, I'll lower the music level. Oh well, it was hard. I was in shock for most of that week. So obviously, my dad's death was a great blessing to him, but I don't think that's the main reason that God says that death of his saints is a blessed event. And I'd like to give you some other reasons. Again, echoing some of the things that Pastor Nikki has said. First of all, I would like to say that we have to recognize that God did not mean for us to be here on earth very long. It seems to be almost self-evident to say that, but sometimes when you're young, you think that you're going to live forever, and you don't think about the fact that, you know, in a few decades, you're going to leave this planet. I think it's very helpful, it was for me, to realize at an early age that life on earth was not going to be what I wanted it to be. I was extremely disappointed when my parents got divorced, and extremely sad when I ended up living with somebody else for 10 years and having my parents visit, you know, once or twice a year. So it was devastating, but what it kind of weaned me of the illusion that earth was going to be heaven. And And then I had some close calls with death later on, and I just realized, you know, life is very fragile. People are very fragile, and life is very temporary. And I think that's a healthy thing to have. Not morbid, but healthy, because it's the truth. And for many reasons, I grew up longing to know the truth. I guess because people weren't telling me the truth. When you're a kid, people don't tell you a lot of things that are true that I wish they had told me. So 80 years, plus or minus 20, is really what mankind is given nowadays. 60 to 100, somewhere in that range, most people die. unless you're, of course, you're Dick Clark. See, some of the older folks got that. So the poet is right that we live in a small twinkle of time twixt two eternities. A small twinkle of time twixt two eternities. That bears repeating. It was so good. We are here, and then poof, we're gone. Or as Psalm 103 says, as for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like the flower of the field, for the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and its place knows it no more. It's a healthy thing to know that the wind is going to pass over us one day, and we're going to be gone. Unless, of course, Jesus comes back first. And folks, I know you're going to think I'm even more weird, but I believe Jesus is coming back while I'm alive. And I'm 74 this next week, so don't give up on that. I don't plan on being buried. I plan on being there and seeing him come over the eastern horizon with the shout of the archangel and the blast of that trumpet. Amen. And I'm looking forward to that. But to be honest, I'm happy it is not happening now. And I have to just tell you, I'll be more weird. I'm glad there's still more time for more people to get saved. Yes. I don't want Jesus to come back now. I'm sorry. I want Jesus to wait and, well, fulfill the scriptures. You know, Matthew 24 says, all the nations have to hear, and then the end will come. Well, there are billions of people who have never heard the gospel once. Billions. And I want them to have a chance. That's my greatest burden, has been since I was a kid, that people would be able to hear the gospel. Because the gospel kept me from self-destructing as a young boy. And I want every person to have the relationship with God as their Heavenly Father and Jesus as their Savior that I had, that kept me from self-destructing like the rest of my family was. So, but we aren't going to die. Every living creature was born to die, from ants to elephants to humans. Secondly, God made us for heaven. This again is one of those intuitive things. Because we grow up, we're on earth, everything is earth, 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 you know, five senses and all that. So it's hard for us to tune into the fact that everything we're sensing with our five senses or more is not our final. We're not designed for this world. Once you become a Christian, you're a new creation. Yes. And somebody, some theologian has said, it's like you're a new species of species. Your spirit is alive. When most of the planet, the humans, their spirit is not alive. God wants them to be alive, but they're not. You're dead in your trespasses and sins. So the thing that lives forever, your spirit, is spiritually dead. But when you become a Christian, you're spiritually alive, and it makes you into the kind of person you could never be without that. Mm-hmm. You're now the character of Jesus is being inculcated, is being percolated in you. The power of Jesus is available to you through the Holy Spirit. And the purpose of Jesus, to live, to bring in the lost, to get people to heaven, so that God will be glorified as they see our good works and glorify the Father and then turn to Jesus. All of that begins to happen when you're a Christian, and that doesn't happen if you're not a Christian. So we're very different. We are a peculiar people, a holy nation, a royal priesthood. We're different, and we're supposed to be different, and we should not be like the world. We should be better than the world, but not live for the world. So God made us for heaven, and all those who die faithfully in Jesus will end up living in heaven forever, not on earth. There will be a new heaven, a new earth, but it's a heavenly earth. So the Bible is very emphatic that earth is not our home. In fact, there's two words it calls us in the Bible that is, again, one of those divine oxymorons. The Bible says that we are strangers and aliens on this planet. We are strangers and aliens. Actually, those two words, strangers and aliens. This is not our home. Ephesians says that our citizenship is in heaven. So from the very get-go, as soon as you become a child of God, God says, you're there, you're on temporary assignment. You're TAD, as in the military, temporary active duty on earth, but your PCS, your permanent change of station, is heaven. If you like that military stuff. All right. Thirdly, God has been waiting for each Christian for millions of years to get to heaven. How do we know that? All right. Ephesians 1, 3 to 5. And if you haven't memorized or mostly memorized these verses, I encourage you to, because it's foundational. Ephesians 1, 3 to 5 says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Just as," I'm going to slow down for emphasis, "He chose us before the foundations of the earth. In love, He," the Father, "predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to Himself according to the kind intentions of His will." Wow. Wow. Before time began, before there was any stars or any galaxies, God said, "I chose you to be adopted as my son or daughter through Jesus Christ. I predestined you to adoption to me according to the kind intentions of my will." So God had kind intentions. He chose you. He knew you before the world was made. So that's probably millions of years ago, I'm thinking. A long, long time ago. So that's number three. So He's always loved you. So I want you to imagine, knowing all this for a moment, that you are God, that you're God the Father. What it would be like to be that Father who knew all of these humans He was going to make and chose them to be His children, predestined them to be adopted as His sons and daughters. I want you to just think about that for a moment. What would it be like for Him to wait for them to come home to heaven? According to Psalm 139, even after you were born, God knew how many days you live on the earth. So He wastes millions of years, He births you, and He gives you 60 to 100 years, somewhere there. And He knows. So if you were God, what would that do to you? Holy cow, they're coming home. They got 10 more years, and that my child is coming home. He's got 5 more years. He's got 20. He's got 40. And that child that I love, that I chose, I predestined to be my son or daughter, is coming home. I've waited millions of years for this. I've trained them on earth through the Holy Spirit to be more like Jesus. I've guided them. I've protected them. I've sent angels to do this and that for them, which they're not even aware of. But I've been doing this in my heart for millions of years. I've waited for them to come home. And now they're getting close to death. You start to get the picture? And Jesus said, "Look, Father, look, that one there, I died for him. I died for her. I have personally made a home for them up here, just like I promised in John 14. I can't wait to show them that home. And that's one of my joint heirs that's about to come home. I am so excited to show them all the adventures we're going to have as jointly ruling and reigning in heaven with me." That's what the Bible says. Jesus has prepared a place for us. Remember in John 14? "I go before you to prepare a place for you, that where you I am, you may be also." That's for all Christians, not just for the 12 disciples. Romans 8. We're joint heirs with Jesus. Joint heirs with Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. What does that mean? 1 Corinthians 6, 3. "Don't you know that the saints will judge angels?" Wow. You know, angels can make mistakes. A third of them rebelled against God a long time ago and left heaven. They have free will. We get, as the redeemed, as the triumphant church, to oversee them. So, you could let your imagination go on and on. We are chosen, we're called. Well, in fact, Romans 8, 29 and 30 says it. Those He foreknew, he predestined. And those he predestined, he called. And those whom he called, he justified. And those whom he justified, he glorified. And that was in the heart of God millions of years ago to do that. He just didn't think about it yesterday. So he's been waiting for millions of years to call you, to justify you for your faith in Jesus, to train you up as a Christian, and get you ready to rule and reign with Jesus. And then he brings you home to heaven and glorifies you and makes you part of the bride of Christ, the church triumphant. And God, that was in God's heart the whole time. So if you were God and you're watching your son or daughter get closer to death, you're not getting sad. You're not getting worried. You're not dreading that day. You're looking forward to the day when that child that you loved and you sent Jesus to die for gets to come home and stand before you face to face, and you get to say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Come into this wonderful heaven I prepared for you." That Jesus died to open the door for you. That's why death is a blessed event for God. And of course, your family's happy. The angels are happy. It goes on and on. 15 years ago, there was a man named Min Kai who used to live in the jungles of Ecuador, and he prayed for me at CBN Chapel. Min Kai. He was one of the warriors who killed the five Americans on the beach back in 1956 when they tried to present the gospel to the Wadoni tribe. Elizabeth Elliot and others have made this event famous through books like Gates of Splendor. There have been movies about it. The story's gone around the world. Life magazine made it very famous back then. So Steve Saint was a young boy when his father, Nate Saint, was killed on that beach that day. So Steve had brought Min Kai to CBN. They were touring the United States. Again, one of the 13 times they did that. And Steve told a story that had never been known until just recently about that event that happened when the five men were killed. They had recently interviewed some of the tribe who had been there that day on the beach killing the Americans, and they sort of offhandedly says, "Oh, by the way, did you know that right after we killed them, we saw these bright lights in the trees above them? And we heard singing. And it said it scared us because then we knew we had done something wrong." They heard singing from bright lights in the trees. Well, it doesn't take much imagination to believe that those were angels. They were rejoicing because they were taking the spirits of those five young men home to heaven to a triumphant welcome, a royal welcome to heaven, because they'd laid down their lives as martyrs for Jesus in the jungles of Ecuador. What an honor. What an honor to die for Jesus that way, to die as a martyr. So I believe that even though Ginger didn't die in a jungle far away, that the same thing happened to her and will happen to all of us who die faithfully in the Lord, that angels come singing songs of rejoicing as we breathe our last breath, and they grab us by the hand and say, "Come, child, come, let's go meet the Father. Let's go be with Jesus." And they take us all the way into heaven, and they get to heaven, and there's this tremendous applause as they walk down this red carpet with the saints on both sides, with family and friends, and the saints of old, Moses and Abraham and Paul and Jonah and everybody, you know, clapping, "You made it, you made it, you made it," as they go on up to meet the Father for the first time face to face, the Father who had known them and chose them, predestined them, and called them, and justified them, and now is going to glorify them. That's why it is blessed in the sight of the Lord when his saints die. That's what I believe. So I believe God approves our tears and our grief for Ginger. Obviously, Jesus wept when he was with his friends at the death of Lazarus. But God sees death more truly than we see it, obviously. So if Ginger could speak to us today, I wonder what she would say. Well, you knew her much better than I did. I met her a couple of times briefly, but this is one of the things I think, some of the things she might say. I think she would say, it's all true. It's amazing. God's amazing. Don't be afraid of death. Death is just the beginning of the most incredible life you could ever imagine. I miss you a little, but there was so much joy and peace and wonderful things here in heaven that I'm just overflowing with gratitude and joy. Really, when we get to heaven, the sadness of the last days on earth, which is often true, and all of that will be washed away in the glory that we're experiencing. The Lord assures me that I haven't even begun to experience all that heaven has. I can't wait. So don't waste a lot of time grieving for me. I appreciate the tears and the love you've shown to my dear husband, but keep your eyes on the Lord. Live for Him. Live for Him. You were made for heaven. You only have a short time before all of you will be here with me. Make your life count for God. You will never regret living for Him, even if it costs you everything. I am waiting for each one of you to come and join me. If you could only see me now, I have never been more full of life and love and laughter. Heaven will blow your mind. So, that's pretty much what I wanted to say. God is looking forward to your death. He's been looking forward to it for millions of years. Jesus died so that you could experience the glory of heaven. He's looking forward to you, meeting you, hugging you, and saying, well done, son, well done, daughter. So I'm going to end up with this little Ricky Skaggs song, Heaven is Not My Home, and then we'll pray after that, okay? Want to play it, Jason?